got 38 wives. Heaven. That was heaven already, right? No, you don't need a planet. No.
Oh, you're right. Sorry about that.
Looking at it, with the exception of Solomon and David, all of those are ones that split from their church. So maybe that's the reason they became leaders, was because they wanted the less restrictive.
Yeah, probably. Right.
Self-selection.
But the irony of it is, every one of these enforced restriction on their followers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, no competition.
Muhammad took as many wives as he wanted, but you can only have four. Yes. You're limited to four wives. Yeah, so anyway. That seems to be the tendency. I get as many wives as I want if I'm the leader, but you get restricted. And I might even take your wife. But Joseph Smith and Brigham Young both took other people's wives. And the interesting thing, if you ask a Mormon about these wives, they deny they ever existed. But there's hundreds of thousands of people that are related to Joseph Smith, and I don't think he could have done that with just one wife, or she was very busy. All right, so think about this. Sex is like a rubber band. E.O. Wilson has a great quote that culture keeps sex on a leash. And I'm going to kind of look at that in a little bit different. Instead of a leash, I'm going to call it rubber band. We're going to look how that works. So let's say that this is what your religious training is. Of course, it's on the less restricted side. The more restricted side. Almost all religions are over here. The only religion that's not over here is Unitarians or some of the pagans. You know, they're probably more towards the middle or higher. They're the only ones our research finds that there is positivity about. So let's say that your genetic predisposition is right here. Now let's pretend this is a rubber band, and you can see what the religion requires of you and what your natural predisposition is are pretty close. You're not going to have a hard time staying married. You're not going to be out having affairs. You're not going to have sex early in life. You're going to take the promise ring and pledge to your family you're not going to have sex. All that's going to just work fine with you, and when you get about 20 years old, you'll get married, you'll have kids, and your husband will stay, or wife will stay married the rest of your life. It's a natural thing for you. Just like being an extrovert is natural, or being an introvert is natural. The less restrictive is going to fit right into that environment. If this were a female in Saudi Arabia, no problem. Can't see why one woman would want another husband or would want to have an affair. Now let's ask, what if your social sexual orientation was farther out there? You'll notice the rubber band's getting stretched a little bit. Well, that rubber band is constantly pulling and pulling and tugging at you. Very likely that you're gonna not feel comfortable sometimes around your religious requirements. And you may step outside those religious requirements, and when you do, you're going to get condemned, or you're going to feel very guilty because your religion is teaching you all this guilt. Now, what if you are way out here? What if you're scoring a 7 or an 8 on the sexual orientation, and you're raised with this religion? You are one miserable son of a bitch. Think about that. You are chomping at the bit. You love sex. You don't understand why you have to be in love with somebody to have a good romp in the hay, and yet your religion tells you. Now, you didn't learn this intellectually. It's just built right into your genes to want to get out and have fun, to be adventurous. You're probably also a mountain climber, or you like climbing cliffs, or you like running marathons, or you do something, you like traveling to foreign countries all alone. That's adventuresome. And that's probably going to coincide with your less restrictive life orientation. So we can see that if you're born to this family, this religious family, say John Smith's family, but your genetics are over here, you're going to be very, very miserable. And your parents, because they're so committed to this idea that spare the rod, spoil the child, are probably going to beat the crap out of you because you're not following this. But it would be equal to beating the crap out of a kid because they're an extrovert, or beating the crap out of a kid because they're really good at math. I mean, it makes no sense. Why would we punish somebody for their natural tendencies? That's the theme of the book. Why don't we let people be who they are? There's no crime in it. There's actually less crime in countries that are less religious, there's less rape, there's less divorce, there's less abortion, there's fewer abortions in Sweden than there are in a comparable southern state in the United States. I mean, all those things, STDs, teenage pregnancies, all those are lower in secular countries, and they're lower in secular states in the United States. The lowest abortions, lowest STDs, lowest teen pregnancies are in places like Vermont and Massachusetts. And the highest are in places like Texas, Oklahoma, Alabama. Wherever religion is, you're going to see sex-related problems. And that's whether you are in Saudi Arabia, India, or southern United States. Wherever there's high levels of religiosity. Because religion, look at this, the average person is going to be here. No matter what religion you are going to be under constant pressure to abide by this restrictive religiosity, but the average person is going to be at least here, and half of them are going to be higher than you. And a lot of and a lot of the leaders are going to be over here too. And they're going to be having affairs, they're going to get caught, they're going to do inappropriate behavior. Look at the Freedom From Religion Foundation, the black collar, how many of you get that? The black, their newsletter, FFRS, their newsletter? Oh, nobody does? Oh, yeah, at least subscribe. $40 a year just to get their newsletter. Because in the back of it every month are hundreds of ministers who've been caught with their pants down. Now, I don't mean just pants down, I mean illegally with their pants down, like flashing people or raping children. And these aren't priests. Some of them are, but a lot of them are evangelical ministers, Pentecostal ministers, hundreds and hundreds that you never read about in the news media.
I'm sorry, what's the name of that again?
The Freedom From Religion Foundation. They have an entire department dedicated just to finding all the predatory churches. There are thousands of them every year.
You need a department to find all.
Well, they don't advertise it. There's a website called StopBaptistPredators.org. And every day, practically, there's a new picture of another Baptist minister. Because the Baptist church absolutely will not do anything about these predatory ministers. And because the Baptist church is so diffuse, there's no central control, a minister can get caught, you know, two or three times doing something bad, and they just fire him, and he goes and preaches another church. Or whatever. But predator Baptists are just like predator priests. They just go to another church. When I was growing up, we had a minister that got caught three times. The church my parents founded, Riverside Christian Church in Wichita, Kansas, hired this guy as the minister, and within 2 years, he had had an affair. My parents were some of the people that helped catch him and basically convicted him at the board. And what did the board do? The board said, "We'll forgive you." Well, my parents were pissed off about it, and they left and went back to the church that I was raised in, actually. So they only stayed 2 years in this new church that they had helped found. 3 or 4 years later, he's caught again. But by this time, he's been able to stack the board in his favor. And once again, they don't remember the earlier one. Only a few of them do. He gets by with it again. They forgive him the third time. I mean, the second time. The third time it happened, this is cool, my then father-in-law was the chairman of the board. And he knew my parents through me. Although he had joined the church later, he called me up and said, "Do you think I could talk to your dad about something?" I had no idea. Well, sure. We're in-laws, right? So he called my dad up and he asked my dad, "What did this minister do?" My dad gives him the whole story. And my father-in-law says, "Well, that's exactly what we just caught him doing, so we're going to fire him." So after the third time, he finally got fired. So what did he do? Oh, he had a brother. He had the second largest church. His brother had the largest church in our denomination. They were big churches. And his brother got caught doing the same thing, but they forgave him. About 10 years later, they caught him embezzling money. They fired that sucker right there. You can fuck anybody you want, but don't take money out of the business. Both of these guys eventually left and went down and founded more churches under their father's rubric in Oklahoma, Tulsa, Oklahoma. Sound familiar? So it's just everywhere. And what you don't, if you've ever been in a church very long, you know that there's sexual shenanigans going on all the time. And there's rumors of sexual shenanigans going on all the time. In fact, what would people talk about if they weren't talking about the sexual shenanigans of somebody? I mean, the singles group...
They'd be talking about Grace.
Well, they do talk about her a lot. She's very popular.
I was going to say this too. Of course, the male priest can get away with that. But if you're a woman and you're in a denomination that you can preach in, if you get caught, you don't get forgiven.
Women are held to very different standards.
I know that to be true.
Yeah. So, religion and the shoulds. Now I'm going to kind of wrap this up here. Religion. All naturally sexually restricted religious person. Let's say, if you marry somebody and they're sexually restricted and they're religious, they not only have this inhibition about their sexuality, but they've got the guilt ammunition their religion teaches them as well. They've got a double-barrel shotgun. And the first barrel is, I'm not that interested in sex or adventurous sex in the first place. And the second place, my God says I can't do it, and you're guilty, you're going to go to hell for doing it, so it's two barrels you got. It's bad enough if you got a sexually restricted spouse and you're unrestricted, but it's doubly bad if they're religious too, because they've been programmed to think they are sexually upright because they're following Jesus. Well, what I'm going to suggest is they're not sexually upright because they're following Jesus, they're sexually upright because they're restricted, they're born that way, their genetics say, you're not that interested in adventurous sex. You don't care about pornography. You don't care to have a threesome with somebody. That's just not your thing. And so what you're going to do is judge anybody who's not like you. It's kind of like an accountant judging you because you can't do double entry bookkeeping. Well, I can't even do single entry, whatever that means. I barely get my checkbook balanced. So to condemn me for not being a full-blown accountant, it's stupid. And it's the same thing religions do. They condemn people for being who they are. They condemn homosexuals for being who they are, and they condemn sexually adventurous people for being who they are, because religions are by definition sexually restricting. So, it'd be like somebody saying you're stupid in accounting and you're stupid in linguistics because you only know one language, so you're stupid. A linguist telling you that because I've got five languages, you must be a dummy. Well, that's kind of what the religious are saying. I'm sexually upright. I'm good at accounting. I'm good at languages. Therefore, you're the stupid one. When in fact, that's not the case. We have a wide range of characteristics. So in religious stupidity, people say you are stupid for having a sexual tendency that's counter to the religion. And you know, these darn religions are saying now, well, even if you were born, they're even saying, well, maybe you were born homosexual, but that's God's test of you. How many of you have heard that bullshit? Yeah. It's a thorn in your side, right. Well, Paul was probably gay when he said that, or he had an extra mistress, or maybe he drank too much wine. I don't know, but he had a problem, and he wasn't telling us what it was. I wish he'd tell us. You know, maybe he's like any other evangelical minister, getting a little on the side occasionally. With a sexually restrictee, as I said earlier, restriction comes naturally to them. With a sexually unrestricted, it's not. So let's just put some combinations together here. Look at this. What if you're a restricted, person, and you marry a restricted person? No problem. You're probably going to stay married the rest of your life, whether you're religious or not. If you are religious,
That's a secret of marriage in India.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah. Both being religious?
Restricted.
Yeah, right. So whether you're religious or not, you're still going to believe, well, it's the religion that made us so faithful to each other. It's religion that made us able to stay married for 50 years and all that stuff. Well, what happens if you're unrestricted and you marry an unrestricted? Unrestricted people.
Divorce.
No, you can have an open marriage. You can be swingers. You can be polyamorous. And you probably will get divorced. I mean, fairly likely, the prediction is divorce. Now, whether you stay married for 10 years or 20 years, you're probably still going to get divorced. Unrestricted tend to do that. What if you were restricted and you marry an unrestricted?
Divorce.
Yeah. That's going to be miserable for both people. But if you're religious, and now this is, say you're both non-religious, but now you add religious restricted to an unrestricted, you've got real problems, because not only are you tempted to go out and do things, but your spouse is going to put the guilt trips on you about Jesus.